We have to start with the ineptitude again of the Mets. And I didn't even, Kim, you know what? Last night I'm up late watching that game. I had to work at SNL. I didn't even want to talk about the Mets today, right. Honestly. They're so irrelevant at this point. Who wants to talk about them? But obviously with the news, with the owner's tweet, we have to.
I was going to say, it's not really because of their ineptitude. We've gotten used to that. It's because Steve Cohen tweeted. Do you have the tweet in front of you?
I do have it. Go ahead. It's hard to this is from Steve Cohen on Twitter, the Mets owner. It's hard to understand how professional hitters can be this unproductive. The best teams have a more disciplined approach. The slugging and OPS numbers don't lie. Kim, your thoughts?
Well, it sounds like an owner who is really starting to find his way a little bit, believing he can make that kind of a conclusion. It's obviously damning. I was just trying to look up the slugging numbers. I think the Mets might have one player in like the top 50. I'm assuming that's Alonso. I didn't get that far to find out who it was, but I can check that at a break maybe. Steve Cohen came in and bought the Mets, not because he had to, but truly because he wanted to. You know, he could lose the Mets tomorrow, and in terms of his life and his finances, there wouldn't be some, you know, it's not a family endeavor mm-hmm. for him. You know, this isn't.
It's an extra play thing.
Right. Yeah. It was like, why don't I do it? Okay, I'm going to do it. And second time around, he actually did do it. And he's the Mets owner. So he can look at this as unemotionally as he wants to. And that's a pretty fair appraisal from a manager. Twitter obviously allows that for him 24/7, as we all well know. But I think with Steve Cohen, it would lead you at this point on August 18th to believe changes and big changes are on the horizon, unless the Mets somehow find themselves. But the Mets have been playing bad baseball for a long time now.
No, they stink.
The best baseball they
them.
Played this season was with the fill-ins when they were energized and you saw guys playing out of their minds, and Kevin Pillar came back from the broken nose after getting hit in the face fast, and he was an inspiration. That was the best time of this Mets season. And Sal, right now that seems like about 2.5 years ago.
Couple things from this tweet from Cohen. Number one, I'm not saying he's inaccurate. I love when people are held accountable. Nobody, it seems, within the Mets organization, at least publicly, has held anybody accountable. Not the players themselves, not the manager. Finally, until Zach Scott a week ago or 2 weeks ago said that they've been playing mediocre baseball. And that ruffled some feathers in the clubhouse. Oh, how could you dare speak the truth about us sucking? We are horrible. And the GM finally says we're mediocre, and everybody has a problem with that in the clubhouse. And they think that they're better. Oh, Alonso, wait, you'll know. Oh, it's early. You know, it's not about how you start. It's about how you finish. Wake up. They need to wake up. So from that aspect, I don't mind that the owner holds them accountable. However, Kim, this is an owner who has tried to preach positivity. He's been open about his positive, you know, thoughts and vibes on Twitter. Met with the team feeling good vibes going into the weekend against Philadelphia. Oh, they got swept. And now that they got swept by the Dodgers and are about to get swept by the Giants today, now he comes out and publicly embarrasses his team. And here's the bigger issue that I have with that, where obviously that's going to ruffle some feathers, and he's the owner who can do what he wants, but now you're embarrassing your players who you kissed their rear end the majority of the year, and he's going to learn the hard way here. However, he wants to talk about OPS numbers. What's George Springer's OPS numbers? And I know you're thinking, Sal, let it go. No, I can't let it go, because George Springer would be the best offensive player on this Mets team, hurt or not, and they had a chance to get him. And Steve Cohen and Sandy Alderson didn't want to go the extra year, $25 million. So that's why I'm bringing that up. So it's his responsibility, Kim, to go get better players. Yeah, it's hard to understand how professional hitters could be this bad. You know what? Go get some good hitters.
But it's not his responsibility to evaluate players. It's his responsibility to open the checkbook and to trust those who evaluate players for a living and to trust them. So it's not, it is not Steve Cohen's, I can't believe it's even his desire to get down in the muck in terms of making those decisions. Why would he want to? He's actually not qualified to do that. You could argue the people that he has in place right now aren't doing a great job at it either. But He can't. He's not going to make those kinds of decisions.
But he closed the deal on Lindor, did he not? He wanted. On Lindor. I mean, he goes the extra whatever mile that Lindor
that's
wanted.
That's opening his pocketbook. It's not getting to know. He didn't get to know Francisco Lindor somehow and evaluate, you know, whether he's better from the right side or the left side, whether he has better second halves,
right.
Which apparently he always does, as we know, and we're not going to see him for most of the second half.
But
I mean, that stuff is not the owners. No owners doing that.
But
few owners are doing
which
that.
Which is fine, and I get what you're saying, and maybe there's two different arguments here, but the issue with Springer was the Mets didn't want to go the extra year, $25 million.
But that's on him for money. It's not on him for evaluation of a player.
But I don't care. But if he sees it and says, you know what, if he's a good player, give him the extra year, $25 million. When Alderson goes to him and say, look, here's what we're deciding with this, and I don't know whose decision it was. I mean, I'd love to find out, but I'm assuming at some point Alderson went to Cohen and said, okay, we could have this guy who could fill the void in center field. He's a legitimate major league outfielder and a terrific offensive player. He's done it in the clutch. George Springer, we offered him $5,125. He wants $6,150. This is where we're at with
right.
that.
And
Steve
he
Cohen.
Said no.
Well, he could say, yeah, go the extra year, or he could say, hey, I trust
right.
you guys. However, they made a mistake. But my point is, it's not with the players that you have there. Go get better players. I mean, it's as simple as that. The Mets don't have enough good players, so you can. And Kim, that tweet is honestly offensive. I mean, if you're a player, you think that that's going to go over well in the clubhouse. If you're a player for this type of owner,
I don't
do you
know
like that.
It's offensive. I don't think it's offensive.
You wouldn't be bothered by that as a player?
I'd probably be bothered by how I'm playing. I'd probably be bothered by the fact that they look non-competitive in most of these games. I'd probably be bothered by the fact that they don't score. I'd probably be bothered by the fact that truly, and I don't mean this as a shot at Alonso, Alonso's greatest achievement this season is going to be winning the Home Run Derby again.
And he's been their best player
to date. Of course he has.
I mean, he's been able to stay healthy at least for the
he
most
has.
Part.
He's
and he's been
mostly
producing.
Healthy, which sets him apart.
And
yes,
he was clueless
absolutely.
With his talking. I mean, we could get into that too. But yeah, they think they're better than they are. They don't hold accountability within themselves. The Mets still think they're in first place, or they still think they're going to win the division, yet they're sinking like a rock by the day. So, I mean, when the owner... It's not untruthful what he said. That is to publicly, where he's been publicly praising this team to now lash them after or during their roughest patch of the year, I'm not so sure that's going to go over well. And I'm not so sure that would have been the way that I would have handled things.
But I think that you're seeing the idea Steve Cohen's going to handle it truly his way. And he's not the Wilpons. And for a long time, Mets fans wanted to celebrate that. Great, the Wilpons are out. We're going to spend money. Well, with spending money, you might have an owner who says, yeah, I'm spending the money, but I'm not going to go quietly. I'm not going to just sit in my owner's suite, take it all and talk once when the season ends or once in spring training or however the heck, you know, a baseball owner could do it.
It's George-like. And I know Steinbrenner didn't deal with Twitter.
I hate those comparisons.
Well, what do you mean? He's an owner who was vocal about his team. It's an exact comparison.
I guess. It's not an exact comparison.
He's an owner of a New York team.
It's
that
a whole different era.
Well, but that's
he
what I mean.
He was sending those missives via fax.
Well,
and Mike and the Mad Dog were going nuts reading them, and it was some of the best shows that they ever did when they got a missive from George.
Exactly, and this is a missive, so to speak, and I used to love those via Twitter. I mean,
yeah,
obviously Twitter wasn't
sure
around when George was there, but... I mean, that would be the comparison. And I know that we don't know yet. He's still new in his ownership. We don't know what his temperament is going to be. But
we're finding out.
Yeah, exactly.
We do know.
Exactly.
We know he's not a patient.
You're starting to see
he's
it now.
He's not patient.
But.
Listen, there are owners who are patient who see the long haul, the long scope. A lot of owners do that in both of the sports I've covered the most, which are baseball and football. And then there are owners who are much, much more impulsive and impatient. And that appears to be what Cohen is going to be. And it's actually more entertaining.
For
and it's
us,
more interesting. Now, 100%.
Do you like that approach, though? I mean, to a certain extent.
I think at this point, the Mets, there had to be some sort of a reckoning about what the Mets are putting on the field, game in and game out. They look terrible at the plate. They don't score runs. They certainly don't score enough runs. And they look like a team floundering. I actually think they look like a team that's lost its way. And I attribute part of that to the Jacob DeGrom effect. Superman is not putting the cape on anymore for the Mets.
Yeah, I mean,
and
maybe.
Sal, I have no doubt. When the best player leaves a locker
room. But their offense has stunk all year.
I understand that, but he could save them. He could give them hope. He was their best part of their season, and he's gone.
And prevent losing streaks, significant losing streaks like that's happened. I think it's more than that. I mean, obviously, that's a factor.
It's more than that.
Yeah.
If you don't think that's a factor, you're nuts. You take the best player, whether it's a quarterback, whether it's a team without a great quarterback, so it's a great skill player, a great defensive player, You take Aaron Donald off the Rams, their personality's changing.
But the Mets have had DeGrom healthy for the last several years where he's winning Cy Youngs, and they still come up with squat. They haven't sniffed the playoffs. So, I mean, that's the other argument. And, again, this year when he was there, I'm not saying it's not a gut punch, because it is. They need him there every 5th day. He's the best pitcher in baseball, no question. But this team is not very good. Even with him, they struggle to make – they haven't made the postseason in years.
They were in first place with him, and they're not without him. That to me, makes my argument. They were a first. You may not think they were very good, and I didn't either. And I hated how they gave away doubleheader right. games. They gave away the second game too often for my liking. We talked yesterday about how they went into the series against Pittsburgh. They come out of the All-Star break against Pittsburgh. They made Pittsburgh look like a contender. I hated all of that, and I hated their approach, and I hated their execution. But they were a first-place team with DeGrom. Without him, they look like a last-place team.
So if you are one of the players in that clubhouse, Kim, and you read this, because they're going to read it, they're going to hear about it, they're probably they've already seen it on Twitter, and you read that and say it's hard to understand how professional hitters can be this unproductive, that wouldn't bother you as a player?
Take it syllables by syllable. Mm-hmm. What can you possibly quibble about? He didn't say, are these guys, you know, eating huge lunches and then they don't have energy for the games? He didn't say something outlandish that you can question. You can't question one syllable of what he wrote.
I know, but
Grow up. There's bad news in professional sports, Sal. I hate to tell you. I mean, these guys have to understand that what they're doing is not good enough. And when the manager's not going to exactly call them out, for probably many reasons, when the GM said what he said about how they needed to hydrate more, and I think that very night Marcus Stroman needed, you know, electrolytes on the mound mm-hmm. because he was cramping up. Granted, the real field temperature was like 106, so I do understand that. But you need to send a message if you're Steve Cohen, and we're still learning about him. We know a lot about these Mets. We're still learning about the owner, and the owner is not going to back down, and he certainly is not afraid.
Which is great, other than...
Well, how do you not agree with him if you're a player? Like, what player? Like,
they've been the complete opposite all year. All they've talked about is being coddled and preaching positivity and patience, and they'll be fine.
I don't think they've been coddled. I don't know what that means.
Absolutely.
Give me an example.
What does that mean? The manager, instead of saying, hey, this guy has been no good, or like Brian Cashman would come out and say.
There's not a manager on the planet right now, including Joe Girardi in Philly, who's going to say, this guy isn't good. He might say, he needs a break. He might say, we're going to give him a couple of days.
Well, Girardi used to say it all the time.
Used to.
Right.
How'd that work out?
Well, Brian Cashman this year said, we suck. Quote, we suck. The Yankees general manager said that his team sucked. With the Mets, who actually do suck, they've been saying, oh, no, we're fine. We're in first place. We're a first place team. Doesn't matter right now. We'll wait till we get later. So they have not taken accountability to a man in that group. The manager not once has said, you know what, this guy didn't have it. A guy could get blasted.
Well, Aaron Boone didn't say it either. It was Cashman.
Agreed. Boone's, yeah.
There is a huge difference there.
Yeah.
Well, there is a hands-on difference with a hands-off difference.
The Yankees owner never came out and said that, you know, it's hard to understand how our professional hitters can't do this.
It's on the players. He put it on the players. He did not put it on Boone. No, that was actually more similar than you think.
Right.
It wasn't exact, and it wasn't a tweet. It was spoken. It was a conference call. But he put it on the players. He did not put it on Boone at all, and he did not put it on Cashman.
For a team that has tried to preach positivity and an owner that has tried to be positive and go back at the fans on Twitter, for him to come out with something this negative, I'm not saying it's inaccurate. I mean, look, nobody's ripped the Mets more than I have. I'm not saying it's inaccurate. I don't think that's...
They play in the second half and truly may not play a truly meaningful game for them in the second half.
They might not have any meaningful games. Left.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. Absolutely. Jacob DeGrom is unfortunately not going to pitch again in the second half as it appears, because you're going to get to a point in September where things aren't going to make sense anymore in terms of his... You know, every 2 week MRIs.
Remember one thing too. This was a team at the trade deadline that instead of, and I guess there were some reports last night, Andy Martino of SNY reporting that the Mets couldn't have gotten Chris Bryant even though they wanted him and whatever. Let's forget about that for a second.
And he would have helped.
They were talking about how they didn't want to interrupt the clubhouse chemistry. They didn't want to mess that up. Hence going out and getting one of Lindor's best friends, Javi Baez. So it's been about the chemistry and that they love playing together and that they're this and that. And it's all positivity. And now with one tweet, again, I'm not saying it's wrong. That goes out the window. And whatever, which I'm fine with. You know what? Sometimes you should make players uncomfortable. I agree with that.
Of course.
I just don't know if this is the right way to do it.
Oh, I think it was the perfect way to do it.
After the way that they've been behaving this whole time.
I think it was the perfect way to do it.
We'll get your calls, 877-337-6666. Obviously, we got to get into the Yankees. What a big day for them.
Huge
sweeping
day.
The double dip.
The kid from the Bronx.
Velasquez.
Love that story. I love everything about that story. He came through in a big way yesterday, too. His family's still going nuts in the stands. That is a wonderful sports story.
Growing up a Yankee fan and then having a big hit.
From the Bronx, right?
Yeah, right, for the Yankees.
The family's from the Bronx, I believe.
I saw a picture. I don't know if they had it on Yes or they tweeted it out, but he was on Yankee Stadium, the old Yankee Stadium with his Yankee hat on when he was a kid.
Yes,
that's pretty cool.
Awesome.
I mean, that's stuff that dreams are made of.
I love that stuff.
But the fact that the Yankees are even where they are right now, most people had them left for dead. They make a nice little run. They get some trades with Rizzo, Gallo, the bullpen addition. And now all of a sudden, and Alex Cora could downplay it all he wants, just a couple of games. It's more than a couple of games.
He said they're different. He said the Yankees are a different team. He acknowledged that. I think they know what they're up against.
And, well, after the doubleheader sweep, he said something like, whatever. It's two games, whatever. And we'll see.
Well,
I mean, you don't want to, now they got caught. They had that big lead, and now you're caught. Similar to the Mets where, they were in first place. Once you get caught, hard to overcome that. Mm-hmm. So we'll see where the Yankees go from here. I think they're going to the World Series. 877-337-60. I'm convinced now, Kim. It's happening. The Mets are dead. The Yankees are going to the World Series.